it is an exciting day to be in the house of the Lord. I hope that you feel that today is a day where you can receive from God Almighty. He is your Father. I have some very interesting information for you. There was this guy once. His name was Jesus. He had a dad who goes by Father God. He's our dad too. We've been adopted into his family. Jesus and God have this entity, this own entity, this person called the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our helper. I think so far you probably believe what I'm telling you. There is a God and you are not He. There is a Jesus and He is the Son of God. There is a helper called the Holy Spirit. So far, I think you can agree with what I'm saying. And then did you know, before the earth was ever formed, there was also this guy named Satan. He challenged God. The Bible says that he challenged God to such an extent that he challenged and rivaled God for God's position in eternity. Satan decided that he was bigger and greater than God. Satan convinced some of the angels at that time that they should join his team and challenge God. A third of the angels followed the devil. Say the devil. Now say the devil. And the devil has demons. Oh, I knew I'd lose you now, I'm telling you. You're like, no. There's no demons. Say demons. There are demons. They want to take you out, not just of this world. They want to take you out of eternity. They want to cancel you. There's this thing called cancel culture. That is a bunch of hogwash. You are not going to cancel God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. Period. Oh, I don't think everybody in the universe has heard me today. I'm preaching straight from the Bible. You cannot cancel God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. Period. There is a God. We're not Him. There is a Jesus. He's the Son of God. There is a Holy Spirit. He's our helper. There is the devil, the Lucifer, Latavian, the ancient dragon, the old snake, whatever you want to call him. He is against you. He has demons, and he puts demons in charge of tormenting you. They hate your guts. The reason they hate your guts is because they hate God's guts. And anything that God has as a gift to himself or to you, or to the glory of all God's creation, they want to torment. They want to tear down, destroy. And that's you. You are God's beautiful creation. The devil wants to torment you. He wants to hurt you, harm you, not just physically, but even more importantly, spiritually. He wants to take you completely out of this universe. In 2019, it's the latest stats on stats such like this. There were over 19 million point four people who checked them in to a mental health facility. 19 million point four. There are over 5,220 day mental health facilities. It's like a day event. You can go to this facility, get your medication, get a talking to, and they send you out the room. Last week, remember, we talked about there are over 8,000 medications that can be prescribed to you. And they'll kill you too. There are over 708 mental health institutions in America that are provided for you to stay overnight at long periods of time, put you in a straitjacket, chain you down to the bed if you cannot control yourself. Why would it be that we cannot control ourselves? demons. Oh, good answer. Say demons. I hope you understand there's a God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. We all like preaching and teaching about that. Those entities, those beings come right out of the Bible. Guess what? So does the devil and his demons and evilness and sickness and tormenting. Right out of this Bible. And we pretend like it doesn't exist. Here's an interesting statistic for you. In the world, the United States of America ranks number 3 at the top of the list for clinical depression. Three! The most prosperous nation in the history of the universe. And we're at the top of the list out of 200 countries that rank at the top of that list for depression. What? A new car does not solve our problems. A house. Clothes. Men do not solve your problems. I got one woman that says, right? Yeah, right. The rest of you, you bought that. You're into hook, line, and sinker. You're like, wow. Women do not solve your problems. There's nothing that will solve your problems other than the power of the Holy Spirit. Demon possession. Say demon possession. You realize one day Peter was talking out his mouth and Jesus turned around and said, "Get thee behind me, Satan." I'm telling you right now, it is possible later today for Satan to use your lips to say something you ought not to. Demon possession. What, me? It's October. I hate Halloween. And this year we decided to hit it head on. It's the month-long ordeal, even going back to the ancient times where people celebrated the dead, death, sickness, darkness. You understand that right at about this time in the history of the world is about when it's going to be dark at 5 o'clock for like months. It's not a mistake that Halloween falls right now. It goes back to the Celtic people, goes back to the Roman people. And they used to celebrate getting themselves ready for the season of darkness. This whole thing that we're wrapped up in this world, it's not an accident. You are not an accident. You were created to glorify God. Jesus says, who lights a lamp and takes it home and puts it under your bed or under a bowl? You don't do that. You light the lamp and you let it shine like a city on the hill. The devil's job is to take that lamp, that light that you have in you, and squash it out with his demons. The number one cause of death in the United States of America for people under 50, is suicide. You know, I've thought in my life about killing a lot of people. I can understand that. I still have some that I let linger around just in case. If I get cancer, anyway. But I cannot fathom taking my own life. I can't fathom it. You know, there are some things on this planet I can fathom. I can understand. But I cannot fathom taking my own life. What would drive an individual to take their own life? I can understand giving my life. I cannot understand taking my life. What drives us to take our own life? The number one cause of death in the United States of America is suicide. I don't think that we could argue that it's demon possession. This is the month of Halloween. Some of you are still trying to get on this train with me. We got a one-sentence sermon for you. Thank you, Miss Allie, for helping us out. I once was possessed. wicked, and mean. Don't look around the room at people. But now, say now, I'm as cool as a cucumber on All Hallows Eve. Pope Gregory III, 8th century, he decided that November 1st would be All Saints Day. Consequently, there was this Halloween thing that had been lingering around for centuries and centuries before then. So on the very day before All Saints Day, they came up with All Hallows Eve. Just to get you in the mood for All Hallows Eve, we have a presentation for you today.
Ladies and gentlemen, the videos in which you've just watched are not a direct reflection of the views of River Life Church.
Hello, Ghostbusters.
You have? Oh no, they'll be totally discreet.
That one film was from Jeepers Creepers. I've never watched it. I don't watch horror films. So I thought since it was filmed right here in Dunellen, Florida on High School Road, I would watch it. Late at night. Then I decided to myself, that was the dumbest thing I ever did. To have an understanding today. Ooh. Where's our gear at? Oh, where is our one sentence sermon, Allie? There we go. Today, we want to take what the devil has given us. I should have tried that beforehand. And be done with it. All the way done with it. In this culture that we live in, now if you have a candy wrapper, go ahead and open it while I'm doing this. In this culture we live in, the devil wants to hurt you. He wants to put stuff in that brain that you can't get out until it torments you to no end. We have a scripture in the book of Ephesians. Thank you, Miss Allie. Molly Golden's on our camera. Cain Baldeo's on our sound. Thank you all for helping us out today. Some of you were wondering if what I'm actually preaching in today is biblical. Right out of the book of Ephesians. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authority. This is out of your Bible. Evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. But God. Say, but God. In the Bible, and Miss Allie, take us to the next scripture, Mark chapter 5. In the Bible talks about even the apostles and Jesus casting out evil spirits. This is a real thing. A real thing is that evil spirits torment your mind so that you will do crazy things to your body in hopes that you will commit suicide. It's that easy. Don't pretend like there's not an enemy against you. There are TV preachers, and we are one now, you TV preachers that are preaching there is no devil, there is no hell. You are wrong. There is a God. There's a Jesus. We get that right out of this Bible. I love it when people walk up to me and they tear a page out of this Bible and they say, this is the only page that ever matters. I got news for you. There's 1,000 pages and they all matter. There's a God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit. There is a devil and his demons. And we fight that fight every day. The devil's job in life is to get you to forget about reality. Schizophrenia, every single year, on average, 1.5 million, I cannot fathom this, 1.5 million people are clinically depressed with schizophrenia. That means they can't figure out what's right. They can't figure out what's reality. They change personalities. 7 million people on average a year are walking around clinically diagnosed with bipolar. That means they're way up for like days, weeks even, and then way down. It's called manic depressive for days and weeks. 48 million people in America are walking around with what's called anxiety disorder. All this stuff is happening in our brains. It is not an accident. You didn't cause it, but you allowed the enemy to come into your life, and then you allowed him to have a part in your mind and in your brain, and then all of a sudden now you are possessed. Oh, some of you right now are ready to quit everything and shoot me. If Jesus turned to the Apostle Peter and said, get thee behind me, Satan, I'm pretty sure you and I better doggone watch out that we are not used by the enemy. And if you want to diagnose something or anything, if you are used by the enemy, that must mean that you are possessed. Oh, now you hate my guts. But that's okay. I want you to be as far from the enemy as absolutely possible. I want you to be filled with power from on high. We sang one of our songs today. It's talking about Jesus breathing on us. This ancient Hebrew word that talks about breathing on us is actually a word for character. When Jesus breathed on his disciples before he went to heaven, he breathed on him and he said, receive the Holy Spirit. Allow the Holy Spirit to fill you from within all the way out so that when you walk into a room, everything changes because of Jesus and his glory and his power and his Holy Spirit. Be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, not possessed by the devil and his demons. There's only one. You have a soul. You have a soul. That soul is yours. It's your personality. It's your mind frame. It's your soul that makes you like fried chicken, ketchup, those types of things. That's your soul. It's your soul that makes you right now not pay attention to me and you're thinking about food. That's your soul. It's your being. It's the depth of your being. There's this thing called your spirit. There's this thing called the Holy Spirit. In the book of Job, there's this man called Elihu. And Job was being tormented by demons. You understand that? This is biblical. You're like, what? What? You remember the story of Job. You remember when Jesus turned to Peter. So get it in your brain that you are up against a very serious opponent. And this thing about just kind of lackadaisical cruising through this life needs to be thrown out the door like a piece of trash. You have to attack this life in the name of Jesus with the power of his Holy Spirit so that the enemy does not drag you down into a faraway place and leave you for dead. That's what he likes to do. The Bible says it's the devil who seeks to whom he may destroy. We all know these scriptures, but why don't we take them seriously? There is a devil. He's after you. He uses the month of Halloween. I've believed it forever. He uses the month of Halloween just to drum up his evilness. Did you know that 1/4 of all the candy purchased all year long in America, 1/4 is purchased during the month of October? That's a lot of candy. celebrating Lucifer. Now you really hate me. Oh, here we go, one of those guys. No, I'm just buying candy to pass out to the trick-or-treaters.
I didn't exactly mean what you just heard. Here's what I mean. Give out candy with a purpose in the name of Jesus. Yes, you can go buy candy, please do. And then give it out in the name of Jesus. Back to your regularly scheduled program.
I don't know. Don't get caught. Ooh, you remember Mr. Miyagi. You don't? I thought for sure if you... You don't remember Mr. Miyagi? The karate... That's right. I'm getting some of this now. He told the Karate Kid that if he walked in the middle of the road, what would happen? He'd get hit by a car. You got to choose this side or that side. One or the other is safe. In the middle gets you killed. Jesus said the same thing. You got to be hot or cold. How many of you liked iced coffee? Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you like hot coffee? Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you like coffee that's been sitting out for 3 days in the kitchen with cream in it? Yes, I will drink that stuff if it's the only thing available, but I don't like it. I don't like it. It's the middle of the road. Choose you this day whom you will serve. And let it be God Almighty. Social status, the amount of money you have in the bank, the amount of toys you have in your garage means absolutely jack nothing in the spiritual realm. Satan could care less. Matter of fact, I'm talking about America. China's number one clinically depressed people. Okay, not surprising. Yeah, I said it's on camera. Okay, India, second place, believable. America, number third of all the countries in the world to be at the top of the list for clinically depressed? What? 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 I'll tell you what. Now, I love you all. God bless your souls, and thank you for coming to church today. But this is not your answer. Punching a clock is not your answer. Attending a service and sitting in a pew is not your answer. Going home in the doggone name of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit and say, today I start serving Jesus Christ. And every devil and demon needs to get the heck out of my house. I don't care if period. Well, my home this and my job this and my spouse that. Period. You start declaring and then, oh, here we go, name it and claim it, preacher. Oh, we'll hit them all today. You name Jesus Christ, and you claim victory. I'm not opposed to that. Or else, burn in hell. Jesus says, when my word is preached, people are going to love it. And if this message does not feel good to you, I am a feel good preacher. You heard it. Because the gospel should feel good. If it does not feel good to you, you are being tormented by the devil. Period. Well, I didn't like the name of that song, and I don't like your name, and I don't like this, and I don't like that. Think about how difficult we make Jesus' job. And just think for a moment what you brought into this sanctuary. Now, see, some of you are thinking about what your neighbor brought into this, what the person sitting next to you. Now, some of you wonder what I brought into this sanctuary. I'm not pointing my fingers. This is between you and God. I'm thinking the same I'm thinking right now. What did you bring into the sanctuary that is not of God? What do we bring in here that's not of God? The Bible says all have sinned. We all believe that. We're all saved by grace. I believe that. The Bible says confess with your mouth, believe in your heart in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. I believe that. What'd you bring in here today that is prohibiting the power of the Holy Spirit from filling you with His love, grace, mercy, wisdom, and power so that you can be His witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and to the ends of the earth? Here's a story for you, Mark chapter 5, verse 7. With a shriek, "Rah!" he screamed, "Why are you interfering with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In the name of God, I beg you, don't torture me." The clearest description of demon possession is right here in this story, also recorded in Matthew chapter 8 and Luke chapter 8. Jesus spent the evening with his disciples and a storm came up and they were on the Sea of Galilee. Jesus woke up in the middle of the night and he spoke to the storm and the storm stopped. Even the wind and the waves know his name. Jesus on the Sea of Galilee got in at the northwest part of the Sea of Galilee in Capernaum. He traveled southeast and he got to the territory of the Gentiles. He got out of the boat and he began to walk. And this man who was demon-possessed, the Bible says, came running to Jesus. Now, in the name of Jesus, I know we all have decent clothes on. We're all going to eat lunch today and nobody's starving to death. We don't look sick and ail and frail. But in the name of Jesus, if somebody is here today who is sick and ail, they are ailing and they are frail and they are fragile in the spiritual realm. In the name of Jesus, break that bondage here now. In the name of Jesus. Amen. This man comes running to Jesus. When he got to Jesus, some translations say he knelt down and he worshiped Jesus. You see, there's a part of you still left that can run to the mercy seat. You can run to the altar. You can run to the cross. You can run to Jesus. There's a part of you that can drag all the demons in hell straight to the cross and then allow Jesus to pick up the battle from there. That's what this man did. When he got to Jesus, he was kneeling down. Immediately, the demons are the first to speak and they say, "You there, Son of God, Jesus." In those times, if you knew somebody's name, that meant that you dominated them. That was a mysterious, that was a mystical, that was a, what do they call, when you don't walk under a ladder, it's called what? What are they? Stupid stition. That's right. That's what that is. Stupid. The time of day that that was, the time and season of life was the fact that if you knew somebody's name, you had power over them. They call out Jesus' name, trying to intimidate him. He's not intimidated. As the story unravels, in a minute, Jesus is sitting back, and he's kind of cracked his neck a little bit. He's waiting. He's waiting his turn. He's waiting his turn. As the story unfolds, Jesus loosens up a little bit, and he says, by the way, what's your name? And Jesus didn't play the same game because Jesus does not have to play games. He says, "Oh, what's your name?" You know what they come out with? They come out with, "We're a mob. We're a nasty mob, a legion of demons." Jesus is like, "Cool, because you're about to be gone." They begin to beg for their life because they understood the power of God Almighty. Friend, begin to understand the power of God Almighty. Even the demons understand the power of God Almighty, and they shake in their boots. It's a super cool story because there's no way on God's green earth any respectable Jewish individual would have been caught, number one, in Gentile territory, number two, in a cemetery, number three, as the story unfolds, beside 2,000 hogs by a hog farm. So wherever in the world you are at, spiritually or even physically, Jesus will go there and break the bondage that is upon you. Period. He will chase after the one. And if that's you today, he's chasing. And he's on the scene. Do not play games with the enemy. A friend of mine made some money in college because she was telling people's future. She was talking to their dead. A friend of mine. She began to dabble in the Ouija board thing. People began to come to her. Then they began to pay her. Because word got out, she knows stuff about people that she'd never met. This one time, somebody came to her on the college campus. You see, I worked at a gas station. This lady, she's an entrepreneur. She had this stuff figured out. Making money. This person comes to her, my friend, and says, "Hey, I need to talk to my grandmother. She's dead. I need to know where this ring is. It's an expensive ring, and it was in her possession before her death. And nobody, the whole entire family, we don't know where it's at. Would you please talk to my dead grandmother and tell me where this ring is?" My friend, somehow, not knowing the story, not knowing the people, somehow she comes up in her brain with the fact that this ring is in the corner of this certain room under this certain color of carpet. And if you go there, you're going to find it there. The family went to that room, peeled back the carpet. There was their grandmother's ring. She was a medium. I would go so far as to say possessed. Being used by the enemy. Playing games. Don't play games with the enemy. Then my friend decided she would turn her eyes toward Jesus. Look to the heavens and be filled. Instead of possessed, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit from on high. Then my friend decided she would study the Bible. Then my friend decided she would rest in God's peace and seek his anointing. As her life unfolded years later, now my friend teaches at an elementary school. As an elementary school teacher, now God is using her. She was pulled out of her classroom, and she is now a behavior specialist at her elementary school. It's not a mistake, because still in the spiritual realm, instead of allowing the devil to use her, she's allowing the power of the Holy Spirit to come and rush through her that she might be a blessing instead of a torment. And that's my friend Maggie right there. You can raise your hand. Hello. This thing that you're in, this thing of life, not a mistake. You are not a mistake. It's not frivolous, right? It's not to be taken for granted. This, what you're living in, is the real deal. And your soul hangs in the balance. Allow the power of the Holy Spirit to fill you that you might not be possessed. You understand another scripture that's told in the New Testament is that when demons are cast out of you, they run from you. But if you open up your heart and mind again, they will come back and then more. This stuff is real. Walmart wants you to believe that it's fun and games. This demon possession is real. You're either possessed by the devil or filled by the Holy Spirit. those devils and those demons, when they were at the feet of Jesus, they begged for their life and they said, "You there, Son of God, are you going to torment us before our time?" They know their time is coming. And then they begged Jesus to send them into 2,000 pigs, and there's a pig farm nearby, so that they would not be cast into the lake of fire, which is cast into the great abyss, which is cast into hell, which is cast into Hades. It's chamber after chamber after chamber of darkness, bondage. That's the devil's fate. Amen. Don't follow him to that fate. What are you doing? Don't follow him to that fate. Jesus said, "Sure, you can go into the pigs. Sounds like a good idea to me." Those demons go into the pigs. The pigs run. They run over a cliff, the Bible says, and fall to their death. And at that point, most scholars believe that what you're seeing is the first time that somebody is cast into eternal hell and damnation. And those demons got exactly what they deserved, even though they were begging not. Because Jesus does not play games. He is not playing games. He loves you. Today, he's got his arms stretched out to you, and he is asking you, come running. Shake off those heavy hands. Remember that song? Shake off those heavy hands. Da, 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 da. Remember all the songs we sing? I'm trading my sorrows for joy. Remember all those old songs we used to sing? Then remember the new songs we sing. Somebody sent me a song yesterday by Elevation Worship. Somebody, I don't keep up on stuff, so I can't remember if Elevation is of the devil or of Jesus. Can somebody tell me? I can't keep up. That's Jesus? Okay. Well, whatever. The words in their songs are hot, powerful. The Apostle Paul, while he was in prison, other people were preaching against Paul, but for Jesus. Do you understand what the Apostle Paul said? He said, let them be. If they're preaching Jesus and somebody's getting saved, so be it. You live your life, you let your neighbor live theirs, and seek Jesus. It'll all come out in the wash. It will all come out in the wash. Because at the end of the day, you're either filled by the power of the Holy Spirit or you're possessed by the enemy. That's it. That's it. Will you please stand with me this morning? Will my prayer team please come to the front of the sanctuary? If you need prayer for anything at all, we're here to pray for you. We're not going to get in your business. We're just going to take you by the hand with your permission. And if not, we're just going to stand there and pray for you. Pray a prayer of blessing over you. Pray for whatever you ask for. Pray that you be filled by the power of the Holy Spirit. I think it's okay that some days that we get very serious and we say, okay, God, I'm done playing games. I do not want to be caught in the middle of the street. I do not want to be caught lukewarm. I want to be caught productive. I want to be caught chasing you. Today, if you'd like to make Jesus your Lord and Savior, if you'd like to make Jesus your Lord and Savior, if that's you today, please repeat this prayer after me. Dear Jesus, throw out the devil. Save my soul. Send your Holy Spirit to baptize me. Anoint me. Empower me. Thank you for dying on a cross. Thank you for raising from the dead that I might have life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now allow me just to say a prayer of blessing over you before you respond. In the name of Jesus today, draw us close to you, Jesus. For my friends who are hurting, my friends that need a touch from you, wherever they are ailing, wherever they are sick, wherever they are fragile, shore that up today in the name of Jesus. Chase away the enemy of our life. We pray for Rachel Watson today, that you would chase away this demon of illness, this demon of COVID. In the New Testament, when people had broken bones and they couldn't see, the writers would say this demon of blindness. So we need to start calling stuff, it is what it is. It's not an accident. It's not a freak of nature. It's demons that attack human bodies. And it's up to us to reach out to God. Give Davy Watson strength, Lord Jesus, every single day of his life, every single minute of his life. Strength and wisdom beyond years. A desire to chase after you, seek after you, continue to believe in you and the power of your great name. Thank you, Jesus, for showing us that you can calm the wind and the storms. And thank you, Jesus, for proving that you can cast out demons. You can do it all. Today, Lord Jesus, do what you have to do in our lives. In the name of Jesus, amen and amen. Friend, I encourage you today, don't leave here without receiving from God. Allow him to finish what he started in your life today. Spend just a moment, and please, don't worry about the next few minutes or even lunch or even the rest of the day. Right now, allow God to deal with what's going on in your life so that you might be set free and enjoy the presence of the Lord.